Or with someone who makes you feel gray or deadens you, that's your life speaking to you, trying to move you in a different direction. And the truth is, there isn't a purpose or a calling that only concerns you, because we're all here to share what we have, because your life is validated through your service to others. Dr. Martin Luther King said it better than I could, that not everybody can be famous, no matter how many selfies you take, how many postings you do, not everybody can be famous, he said. But everybody can be great, because greatness is actually determined by service. That's big. That's big for me. And this is how it happened. Everybody here who has a job, listen to this. If you shift the paradigm to service, everything changes. Because when I came to Chicago, I was just happy to be on TV and sit in those two chairs, I have to tell you. I love those chairs. They're now going to Smithsonian, those chairs. The chair and the sofa that Tom Cruise jumped on. But I was just happy to be like my father said, don't give up their job. I was happy to have a job and to be on television and to now be hosting a show by myself when I first came to Chicago. And there was a couple of seminal moments. I'm going to talk later about how life speaks to you and it speaks to you in whispers. So there was a moment where we had invited a gentleman on who was doing a show about affairs. The man came on with his mistress and his wife. He's literally sitting there with his wife on one side and his mistress on the other. I don't know who is the booker that convinced him that was a good idea. I don't know what they told him. Anyway, it was a horrible, horrible moment on that show. We were live, and on live television, the husband tells his wife that the mistress is pregnant. Yes, yes. And I felt exactly what you just expressed. I was like, I don't even know why you said that. And also, I was embarrassed for his wife, because it was deeper than embarrassment. She was humiliated. And I was embarrassed for myself and my team to have put her in that position. We did not know he was going to say that, but whoa, it hit me to my core. I could weep now thinking about it. And I just said, whoa, I will not do that to another person ever again. I'm not going to do a show like that. I cannot do that. I will not do that. I will not do that.
You go, Jill.
I won't put anybody in that position, I won't put myself in that position. So that happened. And anybody who's ever made a vow of anything, you know this, once you make a decision, it shows up again wearing another pair of pants, just to see if you really are going to be true to your own word, your own integrity. So that happened 1 week. The next week, there was a show about skinheads.
You just said, I don't sit with monkeys. You think because she's black, because I'm black, we're monkeys? Is that?
It's a proven fact.
It's a proven fact? It's a proven fact that I'm a monkey?
Could be. No.
Go ahead, go ahead.
First thing I want to get off my mind is...
But I want to talk about this monkey stuff.
These skinheads are... ADL, okay?
No. I want to talk about the monkey business. I want to talk about...
Wow, that was a moment. So what I realized during the commercial break was that they were signaling each other during the commercial break. They were doing all their little signs and things. And I thought that I was having them on to expose them. They were using me to expose themselves and to recruit from that tape. I could sense that something really dark was happening, and after the show, I said to the producers, I'm never doing a show like that again. So they said, well, what show are we going to do? You're not going to do the marriage, and you're not doing the controversy, you're not doing that. So what are we going to do? So the shift for me was realizing that, oh, wow, I think I'm on television. I think this is like a show. I'm acting like this is a show I'm doing, when in fact, it's a platform. It's a platform for exposing ideas. It's a platform for sharing and offering energy. And I have to be responsible for the energy that I'm putting out in the world. So when I realized that it wasn't just a show, but that it was a way of using this platform, I decided I was going to be a force for good. That was a decision that I made, that everything that I did was going to intentionally be done in order to affect and bring light to people. So the show took off. The show took off when I made that decision. And everybody comes to a point in your life where you have to make a decision about what is the real reason why you're here. Your job description says this, but the real purpose, the real meaning of what your job and how your job impacts other people, oh, that comes from in here. And what I really wanted for the show was to let people know that they were not alone, that no matter what it is you're going through in your life, there is somebody who's been through it, gotten through it, you see them getting through it, it means you can too. And I wanted people to know that your being here matters. And this is what I started to see. I started to see this pattern show up with the 37,584 something people I interviewed over the years. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people. And it didn't matter who it was I was talking to. I remember going to a prison and interviewing this guy who had murdered his 7-year-old twin daughters. And after I finished the interview, he leaned into the bars and said, "Is that okay? How was that?" The same thing happened when I finished talking to Senator Barack Obama. Is that good? Is that good? Is that
Alabama?
When I talked to George Bush, when I talked to other politicians, when I talked to people who had been victimized and people who were responsible for the victimization, when I talked to celebrities, when I finished talking to Beyonce and she talked to me on the tour.
Beyonce!
She handed me the microphone and said, "Sorry." Okay. So I went, "You are Beyonce, honey. It is very much okay." But this is what I learned. Everybody, after every interview, said the same thing in some form or another. Was that okay? Was that okay? Was that okay? And what I started to understand about those words is that everybody is looking for the same thing. You are. Every argument and confrontation you had with your friends, your children, your boss, and your relationships is always about the same thing. It's, did you hear me? And did what I say mean anything to you? Did you hear me? Did you hear me? Did you see me? Did what I say mean anything to you? Now, I started to see this theme, and then it showed up in my own life. I am a golf widow. Stedman loves to golf. I don't understand it. I tried. In the beginning, when we first started dating, I was like, I'm a golf with my man. I'm gonna hit that ball. I did, twice. And then I realized, I can't pretend to like golf. I just can't pretend to like golf. I don't understand how you can go out with a little ball. And 8 hours later, you still with that little ball. I don't get it. And not even trying to get it at this point. But, okay, so Martha Stewart had been on the show. And Martha had told us, thank you, Martha had told us all how to cook a goose. And I was excited I was going to cook a goose. I'd never cooked a goose before. So it's a Saturday, and you know, you cannot just go find the goose. They're just not at your local supermarket. You gotta call the butcher, you gotta make sure they have some gooses in. Got any geese? So I get the goose, you gotta tie the little legs and stuff the goose and come up with the stuff. It's a process for cooking the goose. But I was cooking the goose because I was looking for a little goose action. Perhaps some post-goose activities. And so this is a nice way to spend a Saturday making this new meal. And do you know that when the street lights came on, he was still not at home? So I said, well, street lights are on, but that's okay, I'm gonna wait. It's okay, goose, just keep basting the goose. And 10 minutes passed, you're okay. I know this has happened to you. 10 minutes, you're okay. 20 minutes, got a little attitude. For 30 minutes, goose is getting dry. 40 minutes, everything's dry. No moisture to be found. And here he comes walking in. Didn't call. This is way before cell phones were the rage, but didn't call. And I have got a full-on attitude, like, woo, Evelina, hello. So he comes in, he's got two little paper bags, and he's brought some cucumbers and some tomatoes, like, brought something for a salad. You wish you'd get a salad here tonight. So I say, look, I don't have to be standing in the kitchen all day long cooking a goose for you. And I don't appreciate that you didn't appreciate that I gave up my time and I was in the kitchen making this goose. I had to go get the goose. And he's like, I didn't know nothing about the goose.